Hi there, Andy from SSL here, and thank you for joining us today as we explore using our SSL UF8 control surface with Studio One. In this video, we're going to cover everything you need to know from connecting UF8 to your system, configuring the SSL 360 software which drives UF8, through to controlling Studio One itself. Towards the end of the video, we'll even cover customizing UF8 to suit your own workflow with the triggering of custom keyboard command sequences from a single button press. Now remember, you can actually connect up to 4 UF8s to create a huge 32-channel control surface. But in this video, we're keeping things simple with a single UF8. So without further ado, let's get to it. UF8 uses an external auto-ranging power supply which is included in the box. Simply connect the power supply to the rear panel connector socket labelled DC. Next, connect UF8 to your computer using one of the included USB cables. If your computer has a USB-A type port, then connect from that port on your computer to the socket labelled USB on UF8. Or, if your computer has a USB-C port, then connect from that to the port labelled USB on UF8. The port labelled through can be used to daisy-chain USB communication through multiple UF8s should you have more than one. So for instance, you would connect the through port from your first UF8 to the USB port on the second. Finally, you'll see two jack sockets labelled FS1 and FS2. These are two standard foot switch connections which can be used to trigger various DAW commands like play and record from a standard momentary foot switch pedal. SSL 360 software is the brains behind your UF8 control surface, and it must be installed on your Mac or PC in order to use UF8. So head to the Downloads section on the SSL website, choose UF8 from the product list, and download SSL 360. Once downloaded, simply follow the steps in the installer. With SSL 360 installed, it's time to open it up. And you'll be greeted with the home page. This is where you'll notice your UF8s appear once they're connected. If you have multiple UF8s, you can simply drag and drop to rearrange as needed. And to help you do this, we've got a really nice identify feature whereby if you click down on the image in the software, the displays of UF8 change to show the logo. Just helps you easily identify which unit you're moving. In this video, we'll be using just one UF8, so I'll go ahead and disconnect the second one. The home page is also where you'll see if any software or firmware updates are required for your system, so be sure to check it out and make sure you're up to date. One of UF8's special features is its ability to emulate a USB keyboard. This allows you to program and stack multiple keystrokes of your most commonly used DAW shortcuts directly onto UF8's keys, saving time, speeding up your workflow. We'll cover the specifics of how to set up keystrokes later in the video, but first we need to ensure the keyboard emulator inside UF8 is set up to operate for the correct geographical location that you're in, i.e. Europe, America, or Japan. Now, as soon as you've plugged in your UF8, you're likely to have seen this keyboard setup assistant window, and this is what the Mac presents when it doesn't recognize a keyboard that you've plugged in. Now, don't worry if you closed this window the first time it appeared. You can always get back to it by going to System Preferences, Keyboard, and as long as your UF8 is plugged into your computer, change keyboard type. Now, before you proceed with the next step, you do need to ensure that SSL 360 is installed and running on your computer. If it is, then go and click Continue, and on your UF8 control surface, press and hold the 360 key for 3 seconds or until it turns orange. You'll now be able to select the region that you're in and click Done. Next, you want to configure 360 to work with the factory shipped Studio One profile. So go to the UF8 tab and then go across to the drop-down list on Layer 1 and select Studio One. Now, we also have options for layers 2 and 3. If we were working with multiple DAWs, for example, we could set up Studio One on layer 1 and something else on layer 2. But we're all set with one layer today. And as you'll see, beneath the layer selection, we have all the user-definable keys, and we can scroll through and change these if we like. We're going to leave this as it is for now and get going. Next, we need to configure UFA as a MIDI controller in Studio One. So I'm going to go to the Studio One Preferences menu and make sure External Devices is selected. Then I'm going to go Add and get a Mackie controller. And I'm going to set this to receive from SLV MIDI port 1 and also send to SLV MIDI port 1. Now, SLV MIDI is the way in which UFA and Studio One communicate via the 360 app, and it's installed as part of the installation process. So if I was using more than one UFA, I would add subsequent ones as Mackie control extenders here, and I'd increment the VMIDI port by one, so port two in this case, like so. And if you are working with multiple UFAs, there's one more step. Go to placement and then drag your controllers up into a control surface placement group. As we're only using one today, I'm going to go ahead and remove this extender, and we're set and ready to go. With our setup complete, you can see that UFA has sprung into life, and we have our track names and track metering across the center of the displays. Now, as we move down into the main controller section, of course, we have our solo, cut/mutes, and of course, select keys. Now, a really nice feature of Studio One is you can actually press and hold a solo key to do a momentary solo, and you can also do this with the cut keys as well. Now, of course, we have faders here, so these are 100mm high-quality, fully motorized faders, which are nice and responsive over the high-speed USB connection, as you can see. And then above the faders, we have a row of 8 VPOTs, VPOT standing for virtual pot, and what the VPOTs are doing depends on the currently assigned VPOT mode. Right now, we're working with pan positions, as you can see them being altered here, and I can push down to reset a pan to its center position, like so. And then finally, you can see just above the pan position readout, we've got a value on the screen, and this represents our fader DB readout position. Now, before we get into the other VPOT assignment modes with UFA and Studio One, let's take a moment to discuss the selection mode keys on the right-hand side of UFA. So we have Norm and Rec as the two options. Auto is disabled as it doesn't apply to UFA and Studio One's integration. So in Norm mode, you'll see that the select keys on UFA behave as the regular track select keys in Studio One. And I can press the Rec key, and that actually changes the select keys to be record arm keys within Studio One. If I want to get back to regular select keys, just press Norm. The three quick keys at the top left of UFA have been pre-assigned to some commonly used functions within Studio One. So for example, Quick Key 1 toggles the console view on and off. Quick Key 2 toggles the inputs on and off, but we don't have any setup at the minute. And Quick Key 3 open and closes the editor view, which is where we can see our plugins. Let's take a look at the large step channel encoder on the right-hand side of UFA. Now, by default, this will bank me through my tracks one at a time, like this. Or alternatively, I can use the bank keys to bank in multiples of 8, like so. The channel encoder actually has two alternative modes of operation. So if I come and press the nav key, then this moves me around the session timeline, or pressing the playhead cursor. Or I can press the focus key, and this turns the channel encoder into a mouse scroll. So if I open up my plugin here, which is SL Native Drum Strip, I can hover my mouse over the control and then use the channel encoder to operate it. Great for hands-on plugin control. Obviously, the sensitivity will be affected by your mouse scroll speed settings in your system preferences. When you're working in the arrangement view, the cursor keys at the bottom right of UFA have two different modes of operation. With the center key lit, I can do horizontal and vertical track zooming, and I can disable the center key, and now the up and down arrows perform track selection, and the left and right arrows allow me to move between different clips on the selected track. The automation keys at the bottom left of UFA can be used to put the selected track into the desired automation mode. So simply select the track you're interested in, and then press the automation mode you want to engage, in this case, touch. The trim key is disabled as it doesn't apply to Studio One. The send key applies the send levels to the 8 VPOTs on UF8. So press the send key, and you can see that for the selected track, I have access to the sends on that track, so I'm altering the level here. If I push the VPOT, that will reset the send to 0. And the nice thing is I can, of course, flip the sends down onto the faders using the flip key. There we go, I have control there. Now you'll notice that the channel key on the left-hand side of UF8 is lit, and this tells me that I'm looking at all the sends on the currently selected channel. However, I can press the send key again, and you'll see the number one key light on the left-hand side of UF8, and this tells me that I'm controlling the first send slot across all tracks on UF8, like so. And if I want to get to send slot 2, I simply press the send key again, and I've got access to the send levels on slot 2. And I can keep pressing the send key to make my way through the rest of the send slots until I get back to the original mode. The insert bypass key is a nice way of being able to toggle the inserts on the selected track on and off one at a time. Hit the insert bypass key and then simply select the track you're interested in and push down on the VPOT corresponding to the insert you want to bypass. The track function allows me to access a number of key functions on the currently selected track. So press the track key, and I'm going to select the track I'm interested in. Now the first VPOT will allow me to toggle all of the inserts on that track on and off, like so. The second VPOT will allow me to turn the monitor function on and off. Third and fourth VPOTs allow me to select the input and output routing of that track. And then VPOTs 5, 6, 7, and 8 allow me to mute sends 1, 2, 3, 4 using the VPOTs. The plugin key puts the VPOTs into control link mode, which is how you control plugin parameters in Studio One. This is great as it allows you to customize the layout of plugin parameters across the VPOTs for each and every plugin that you deal with in Studio One. Let's take a look at doing this. So to begin with, let's open the channel editor window, and I can see the plugins I've got on the currently selected track, and I can move between plugin slots using the page keys here. So let's get into how we assign plugin parameters to the VPOTs. So start by clicking this cog here, and this will open this little editor section here. Click the down arrow and select control. This will open up the external devices window, and the 8 empty blocks in here represent your currently unassigned VPOTs on UF8. Now, what I want to do first is check in here that recently touched is ticked, which it is. And now what I can do is wiggle the first control I'm interested in assigning to the VPOTs, and then grab the little hand tool and drag this down onto my first VPOT. And now you can see UF8 is updated and the first VPOT is controlling that plugin parameter. I can do the same for the other parameters in the plugin. This low frequency control here. Again, grab the hand tool, click and drag with your mouse, and this is now assigned to the second VPOT. Obviously, I'd repeat this process for as many parameters in the plugin that I wanted to, and this would create the custom mapping of that plugin on UF8. With each UF8 control surface, you have the ability to customize 43 user assignable keys with a mixture of your own keyboard shortcut sequences or any of the commands available in the DAW commands list in 360. The user assignable keys are found at the top of UF8, and you can move between the 5 different banks using these keys here. And of course, you have the 3 quick keys to the top left, which we've already covered in this video. Now let's take a look through some of these pre-assignments. So in bank 1, we've got the transport keys and cycle on and off, and we also have the marker key. Now pressing the marker key allows me to navigate through the timeline and use the record key to drop in markers instead of being a record function. There we go. And also, the fast forward and rewind keys in this mode allow me to move between marker points. Come out of marker to return the fast forward and rewind to their normal operations. In User Bank 2, we've got the modifier keys and click track on and off, etc. User Bank 3, save, undo, and cancel and enter. User Bank 4, I've got the ability to quickly switch what I'm looking at on the control surface to certain track types. So, for example, I can see my buses here. And I can press audio tracks to get back to my audio tracks there. And in User Bank 5, we've got access to the function keys 1 through to 8 in Studio One. And these are really interesting because they can be customized in Studio One. So let's take a look at this now. I'm going to open up the editor and once again, click the cog, just like we did with editing plugins, and control, which opens up the external devices window. Now I can see what the F keys are currently assigned to along the bottom here, and I want to alter one of these, so the one that says show track, right click, assign command, and I can choose from this huge list of assignable commands. Now in this case I want to get the strip silence command, and there we go, that is now assigned to F key 2. Now obviously I want to change the display name above the key on UF8, so to do that I'm going to go into 360 software and click over here, type in strip silence, and if I jump back into Studio One you'll see that I can click on the track and then quickly do a strip silence directly from UF8. Now we've just seen how customizing the F keys can be a really powerful way of adapting UF8 to suit your own workflow. Let's look at this in a bit more detail. So what I want to do is change some of the assignment on the quick keys. So quick key 2, I'm not really using the show inputs function. So let's change that by going into 360. And I'm going to scroll down until I get to the second quick key, which is on show inputs. Now from the DAW list, I'm going to change this to name stroke value. Now when I'm back in Studio One, what I can do is use quick key 2 to toggle the view slightly. So I can look at the plugin parameters and their values or get back to seeing the track names like so. But not only can I rearrange the DAW commands that are available in the list, I can also assign my own custom keyboard command sequences. So let's take an example and go back into 360. And I'm going to go into User Bank 3. And there are currently some unassigned keys in this user bank. So if I go and edit this key here, and instead of choosing DAW command, I'm going to choose keyboard command. And I can click in here and start assigning some of my favorite commands that I like to use often. For instance, option command left for nudging audio regions left for this one. And then the next key down, similar again, type in here option command right and nudge right. And that's done. I'm just going to close this window and let's jump back into Studio One. Let's close these here. And I'm going to select an audio region. And now I can use those commands I've just set up on these keys here to nudge the audio region. Now, obviously, this is just one example of many, many things you could do to customize UF8 to suit your own workflow with your own keyboard command sequences that you use most often. Finally, don't forget that you can save and load profiles to go and work in another studio here on the left-hand menu in 360. And also you have the revert function, which will allow you to revert to the factory shipped Studio One profile should you need to go back. We hope you found this video useful in exploring some of what UF8 and Studio One can do. If you want some more information, please be sure to check out the user guide for UF8, available from the download section of the SSL website. Until next time, thank you and goodbye.